Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Mike Lawrence. I am a very hoarse former journalist who works with the First Communications team, so I apologize for my raspiness. A little too much pollen in the air for me, but I'm going to help facilitate today's meeting. As you know, this is an informational session, and the purpose of it is to explain and to discuss the first decision to move to two championship events beginning in 2017. We have key members of the First leadership here to speak with you and answer questions, including Don Bossie, First President, and Steve Chisholm, Vice President of Programs, and Frank Merrick, Director of First Robotics Competition. Meeting, as you know, is scheduled to run an hour, and Don and colleagues have a brief presentation, a handful of slides with some information in it for you. The intent of that is to address the most common questions that have arisen since the announcement was made, and we've got a list of five of those questions that my friends in the glass booth up there can put up on the screen. So let's take a look at those now, just so you know kind of what we're trying to cover in the next few minutes. What are first objectives with this decision? What process was used to make the decision, and why wasn't the first community asked for input? How does this reduce travel costs, especially for West Coast teams? Doesn't having two championships weaken the competition aspect that helps make any sport exciting? And what elements of the decision are set in stone, and what elements can the community still help decide? These are the themes. We tried to group them based on a lot of the feedback that First has seen. Hopefully some or all of these questions resonate for some of you in the audience. I see some heads nodding. And this will be the focus of Don's presentation. Once the presentation is completed, we'll be opening the floor for additional questions. Our goal would be to leave at least half this meeting time, half an hour or so for that, if not more. If you would like to ask a question, we'd ask that you go up to one of the microphones at the top of the aisles here, left or right, and give your name and your team affiliation as part of asking the question. In the interest of giving more people a chance, we've got probably 100 or so people in the room, please do keep your question brief, around 30 seconds or so if you can, and please do keep in mind the spirit of gracious professionalism that we all know is a key value of the way First operates. So just one more FYI, we are recording this meeting. That's that big camera in the back there. We're doing that with the possibility of sharing the contents of this meeting in whole and part with the rest of the First community, the folks who haven't been able to be here today. So that's the ground rules. Let me take a moment to introduce Don Bossie, First President, and he'll take you through the presentation.
Thanks, Mike. So one of the challenges we discovered early is it's actually hard to see the slides from here. So I just have a different version of them here on the laptop so I can actually see what I'm talking to. So we wanted to take, obviously a couple weeks ago we made the announcement about sort of the plans for the future roadmap of the championship. And in response to that, we heard a lot of comments and feedback. Much of it constructive, so we appreciate that. And wanted to take the opportunity to say that we did hear you. Hopefully we captured some or many of your questions with the list of questions you just saw from Mike. But we also wanted to take the opportunity to maybe give you a little behind the scenes tour that went into the thought process that led to the decision. In particular, probably clear up the first question, we didn't roll out of bed that morning, have this idea, and announce it at noon. This was actually something that, believe it or not, was in the works and was actually a board-level conversation within First for approximately 9 months or so prior to the announcement. So a lot of your concerns and reaction were not completely unexpected by us. We know that change is always something that's a little puzzling, and we also know that the First community thinks that, geez, some of the things First does is really awesome. So why would you change it? You might make it worse. And so I can assure you that our goals in any change we have is to make it better, but better is in the eye of the beholder. So let me take a little bit and explain some of that. So first slide I just wanted to share was a little bit about kind of our objectives and our thought process and how we thought about this and how we came up with a solution. So, of course, our very fundamental belief is to stay consistent with first core values. And one of the things you have to remember, unlike a corporate organization or like the National Football League, which frankly is a money-making business for the team owners, FIRST is a mission-driven organization where we have a very specific mission. And, you know, I think most of you know this, but if you don't, I mean, our mission is to change the culture, not of a certain country or not of a certain group of people, but of the world, to one where science and technology leaders are celebrated and looked up to. And this becomes the type of careers and profession and impact that all kids everywhere dream of having. And so consistent with that, you know, our real mission is to inspire young people, a whole generation of young people, to become science and technology leaders and innovators. Now, to put that in context, today, FIRST programs exist in about 20% of the schools in the United States. It's a much lower percentage outside the United States, but we can use that as a benchmark here in this country. Now, while that sounds great, and you're all very fortunate to be part of that 20%, or maybe a community team that's related to that, but what that honestly means is that 80% of the kids in this country, and a much higher percentage of kids in other countries, do not have access to these types of programs. And in many cases, those are the kids who actually need it the most. They're from communities that can benefit from this the most. And so a big part of what we think about day in and day out, besides ensuring that all of you who are part of the program have an amazing experience, is how do we make this accessible and engageable for that other 80% of the kids? So how do we make this such that, you know, in 5 or 10 years, we can literally have twice as many or 10 times as many teams and students participating in the program? So always thinking about sort of like, how do we enable that growth and how do we facilitate that growth and how does everything we do scale to enable that? So again, that's a little bit different than maybe, you know, the National Football League that is looking for how do we allow each team owner to optimize their profits or their experiences. We tend to think about it, and I know I don't mean to offend anybody with this, but we have to spend a lot of our time thinking about not the people who are in the audience, but the people in 10 years that we really hope are part of the audience with us. So clearly, whatever we thought about needs to be able to scale as FIRST continues to grow and scale. And so that brings to the third bullet point, which is really, how do we enable more kids to have access to these life-changing programs that are the FIRST programs, but also that we think the FIRST championship is an important part of that experience. We're not saying it's the be-all and end-all. I can tell you I've met more than a few teams who said, you know, we had an awesome season, we qualified for championship, we're deciding not to do that this year. Maybe we're out of budget or we want to put the money into other outreach. So we don't see the FIRST championship as the absolute only be-all and end-all of the FIRST experience, but we think it's a key part of it. And we think for kids having the opportunity to come to an amazing place, to spend an amazing weekend with 20, 30, however many thousand of like-minded people, and see that we're more than just sort of a group of people who find this interesting, but we're really part of a movement that's going to change the world, we think is an important part of that experience. And you know, I can honestly tell you, since the day I've met Dean approximately 2 years ago, his passion is always, how do we give more kids the opportunity to experience FIRST? How do we give more kids the opportunity to experience the FIRST championship? So it's something that since day one, since my joining FIRST, I know it's something that he has personally been passionate about and trying to say, how do we do that? How do we make this scale? You know, how do we make this reach 10 times as many kids? And then the last part, which again is maybe a practical reality, but one of the pieces of feedback that we get very clearly, and I just heard it again in a meeting this morning, is, hey Don, it's great the kids come here and that championship is a great experience for them, but when I look at what I could do with the money that I hand to an airline in terms of if I could hand that to a school and get a new team engaged, you know, that's much more impactful, that's much more aligned with our mission. So how do I stop writing big checks to these airlines to get kids to one particular city, and how do I start to use some of that resources to get more kids involved? And so obviously, while there's no perfect answer, the concept of trying to think about, well, maybe holding the championship in two geographically somehow separated cities means that it is drivable for more teams. Not every team, and we'll talk about some of the challenges that go along with that. But these are really the overarching objectives that we had in thinking about sort of, well, looking at a whole range of possible solutions, what can we do here? All right, so we're all technical, so I can't talk without a graph. So I thought I would just put this up and share a little historical perspective on the first championship with folks. Ah, I forgot, it doesn't change. Thank you, Mike. So the red curve is actually the number, and so we're using first robotics competition as the proxy here for the approximate size and the number of participants. So the red curve is the capacity at each championship for first robotics competition teams. And the blue curve, by doing the math, is the percentage of teams that existed in that year that were able to attend championship. Now, many of the younger folks in the audience may not realize that back in the early days, 80% of teams actually came to championship when it was at Epcot. Because FIRST was really, really small, Epcot had a certain amount of size. Who doesn't want to go to Epcot for spring break? So a very, very high percentage of teams had attended championship. If you look at the blue curve, it shows how that's changed over the last, you know, decade and a half. And last year, we were down to about 15% of teams had the, we had the capacity for about 15% of teams to attend championship. At this event last year, we announced that we found a way here within St. Louis to increase that and try to get that back into the 20% range. By going to 600 teams, and we're delighted to welcome what I believe the final number is 607 FIRST Robotics teams here to the championship this year. The story for FIRST LEGO League, FIRST Tech Challenge, Junior FIRST LEGO League is much worse. FIRST Tech Challenge has about capacity for about 3% of their teams at championship. FIRST LEGO League, it kills me when I talk to a FIRST LEGO League partner for a country, and they say, oh, we can't even send a team this year. We don't have a slot this year. So part of what we thought about was, all right, well, how do we scale this so that more teams across all programs can attend FIRST Championship, but at the same time, trying to achieve balanced percentages? One of the things that is a little bit harder about FIRST Robotics than the other programs is the fact that it's a fairly time-compressed program. Now, believe it or not, as part of thinking about all this stuff, we actually thought about, well, what if we kick off before the beginning of January? What if we moved that into the fall? What if we had a build period that was longer than 6 weeks? What if we time shifted so that the competition season was longer? And we considered all those things, and they're always on the drawing board. But what we thought was, well, some of those things are pretty important for a variety of reasons, including a number of mentors who have told us that if we moved it before the holidays, it would totally destroy their holidays, their spouses would divorce them, and it would not be pretty, and they would blame me for that. So I just thought that this was an interesting view to give you a historical percentage. You know, again, just to share a dean perspective on this, his view is, you know, a kid's high school career is 4 years. He's like, I would absolutely love to see if every kid involved with FIRST at least had an opportunity to attend championship once in their high school career to help solidify the impact and the magnitude of the movement that they're part of. I'm not saying that we're necessarily targeting 25% as a great number, but we're at least looking to be somewhere in that 20-ish percent kind of range to still make it a program that's accessible to a large number of the teams, but by no means the majority. Remember this time. So let me talk about, and this is probably something that you may not think about on a day-to-day basis, but I just want to share with you a little bit of the challenges of scheduling the FIRST Championship. The first is the sheer size of the event. I don't know what the latest number is for the number of people here in St. Louis this weekend, but I'm pretty sure we're over 30,000 attendees already this year. And if you look at, even with the expansion we had this year, where we went to 600 FIRST Robotics teams, with our current selection criteria, we would be out of slots by 2018 and possibly even 2017. So we've really tried to maximize things here in St. Louis this weekend, try to think about ways to make it a holistic, unified experience for all our programs throughout the city. But and St. Louis has been fantastic in supporting that. It's got great venues. But this really is the biggest event that we can hold in any one city. And we think it's awesome. But when you start to think about, well, in 10 years, if FIRST is 5 or 10 times as big, it's just, you know, there's going to be an extremely small number of teams that can attend or that have access. And it's not a solution that scales. The second thing goes back to the timing. And again, this is where FIRST Robotics Competition is way more time constrained than our other programs. But with kickoff in early January, with the build period, with the competition season, with also, you know, having district championships and such, we're extremely time limited to having this event in the last 2 weeks of April. Once we get into May, a whole bunch of schools in certain parts of the country get out of school. There's AP testing. There's a whole bunch of other testing that goes on. So whether it's us, whether it's VEX, whether you look at any of these programs, the last half of April is really sort of the only time period you have for scheduling a championship. The other negative thing about that is the last half of April is also the peak of the convention business because of the fact that that's a really nice time to attend or hold conventions, especially if you're talking about parts of the southwestern and western United States, sort of the California, Arizona area. So, number one, it's probably the hardest time of the year to find as much availability. But also, the other thing that has happened in the last couple of years is as the economy has rebounded from the Great Recession of 2009-2010, the convention business is booming. And so what I will say is in those areas in the southwestern and sort of western United States, those convention centers are actually completely booked out up until 2020 and beyond. We know we've talked to every one of them ad nauseum. We've begged, cajoled, and done anything we could to sweet talk it. But the honest to God truth is that those venues are really booked out far in advance. And so that's why when I said part of the solution we tried to define would try to maximize the number of teams who could drive to two distinct locations, it's a no-brainer that if we had found something that was ideal and available in the southwestern United States, that probably would have been a nice choice. The trick is also that during that same time period of late April, those not only are the convention centers full, but hotel rates are actually at their highest at that time of year. So we tried to look at this very multi-constrained problem and sort of say, well, what is the optimal solution we can come up with? There is no perfect solution, by the way. I want to say that very clearly. But what we could look for is an optimal. So 12 cities were engaged to look at what's available, what's possible. And we had very extensive discussions with all 12 of those cities. And when we looked at all the options and all the boundary conditions and all the things we were trying to achieve, it turned out the two cities that presented the best solution for us, not the ideal, not the perfect solution, but quite, you know, the optimal solution, was Houston and Detroit. Because they are geographically spaced out by about 1,300 miles between them, because when you look at team concentrations around those areas, we believe that by going from one championship in one city to two championships in reasonably dispersed geographic locations, we're moving from where about 35% of the teams can drive to an event to where over 50% of teams can drive to an event. And that's using sort of a 500, 600, 650 mile type of radius around those cities. They do offer great solutions in terms of multi-venue, really exciting venues. As I said, they're about 1,300 miles apart. We believe they're drivable for at least half of the teams. Now, what is the opposite of that? We still understand that a number of teams are not drivable to those. And I had a meeting with some folks from the Pacific Northwest FIRST Board this morning, and I said, my sincere apologies. I would have loved to put this somewhere that it's more drivable for our friends from Washington and Oregon. I said, unfortunately, there was nothing, and I know this doesn't make that any better for those folks, but it does make it better for a lot of the folks from the Northeast, Ontario, Central Midwest, and down through the Midwest to get to Detroit. And for folks in the southern and Texas and even out to kind of the south central part of the United States, It does significantly increase the number of teams that can drive to those two, but it's not a solution for everyone. And for our international friends, it's really not a solution because they can't drive their car across the water necessarily. Both cities do have major airline hubs, with Houston having Intercontinental Airport and Hobby Airport, which I believe are hubs for United and either Southwest. And Detroit has a major international airport, which is a hub for Delta. This is not anything wrong about St. And again, I want to be very clear. We considered, you know, do we stay in St. Louis longer? We absolutely know what the maximum capacity is here. We love St. Louis. They've been wonderful to us. But again, in trying to look for migrating to trying to get to, you know, if you draw concentric circles around the cities so that people can drive, trying to get those as unoverlapping as possible, that was one of the benefits of Houston and Detroit. So the question came up, well, what's fixed and what's flexible? So what we know are the following, is that each championship will include the first progression of programs. All programs will be there. And again, part of that is consistent with our mission and our ethos, which is, you look like the older crowd in the room, but you are the role models for the younger kids. You are the ones that, and I actually honestly know that you happen to coach and mentor a lot of the younger kids. I mean, the number of first Lego League teams that I've met that you are actually the, you know, the parents and inspiration for is incredible. And so we think it is, and it's fundamentally important to the organization to make sure that we are nurturing and you know, supporting that full progression of kids, getting them involved early, getting them participating in the celebration early, and nurturing them all the way until they go to college, hopefully with a first scholarship. So the progression at each championship is important. And by the way, if you look at the foot space, the floor space footprint of a championship, it's 80-90% first robotics anyways. So I know a lot of people said, well, I'll send those other programs to a different one and we'll go. It doesn't buy you much floor space. The amount of floor space that we actually consume for the other programs is relatively minimal compared to the first robotics program. So what is fixed is that we have signed venue contracts and we'll be here in St. Louis with the expanded championship this year and again next year. In 2017, we will be in Houston on what's called week 8 of the first robotics season, and we will be in St. Louis on week 9 per our original announcement and agreement that I think came out about 18 months ago. And then in 2018 through 2020, we will be holding the dual championships in Houston and Detroit on weeks 8 and week 9, and actually 1 week it turns out it's week 10 in Detroit. So the other thing I can say is that both of those cities have absolutely amazing venues. I think you'll be quite excited. And they provide the same or potentially even a little bit greater capacity for the whole progression of programs. So if that's what's fixed, what are we still exploring? Now, if we really wanted to be nefarious and not be open about this, we would have waited and told you this in a year and a half if we didn't honestly want your constructive input. But we do care what you think, but we also care about the 80% of the people who aren't in the room because they don't even know what FIRST is. We're still the best kept secret. So things we're exploring are the options for a postseason broadcasted event between winning alliances. We understand that finality is important on one level. On the other level, I think we also personally believe that FIRST is not about being the winner, but it's about being part of a community of winners that definitely demonstrate sort of what the potential of greatness is. But we, of course, are looking at these options, and we don't have anything solidified. We're in a number of interesting conversations at this point. And the honest-to-God truth is that doesn't need to be solidified today. But if we did not commit to venues, people say, oh, two championships, that's gonna be worse. Well, the worst option actually would have been not making commitments and not having a championship in 2018 if we didn't lock down a venue because the convention industry is doing quite well. We're also looking at the possibility of opening a percentage of the slots at each championship. So as we announced, you'd attend the championship for sort of your home region, your half of the universe. But we also understand that there is something very cool about getting to meet teams that you may not ordinarily get to meet and experience that. So we're looking at ways, and you know, certainly solicit your input on ways that, well, if we had, so our number one rule is, if you can drive and you want to drive to your home event, we want to make sure you have capacity to do that, because we do not want anybody to have to spend thousands and thousands of dollars on airfare that does not want to do that. Conversely, if you do want to travel and you happen to be a team with a great budget and want to have a shot to say, well, normally I would go to the Houston one, but if I'd be interested in potentially attending the Detroit event this year, we're looking at ways to sort of enable that cross-pollinization without hurting anyone from an access to their home event perspective. And then, of course, we're always looking at ways to sort of how to make it add value and add excitement and add interesting things to the whole championship experience. The thing that's always very impressive to me personally is how many people actually are part of teams that don't qualify for championship, but they still send a couple team members, either as volunteers or just as people that want to come and see what's going on here. And so, you know, whether it's the conferences that we run, whether it's the innovation fair across the street, whether it's just getting to see the whole progression of programs, or whether it's helping other teams succeed, we want it to be an experience that is wonderful and engaging for everyone, and not just necessarily, you know, elite teams or teams who happen to qualify, but for our whole community. So I probably went way over the time I was promised. But that's sort of a little bit of the story behind the story, some of the thinking. I'll be very clear, there is no perfect solution. And maybe there's a perfect solution for you personally, but we're trying to think of a perfect solution that gives a great experience to you, who are the fortunate 20% of kids who have access to these programs, but also thinking about how do we make this an engaging and accessible experience for the 80% of kids who today don't even know what FIRST is. So with that, I'll shut up and turn it back over to Mike. I don't know if there's any questions we missed.
Well, let's put the questions back up that we started with. And there they are, the ones we read at the beginning. And we've got about half the meeting time left. So these are the ones we thought would be the main topics for folks. But if either you feel that there's more to explore with this, if you want to ask a follow-up, or if you have a question on a different subject, we'd invite you to go to either the microphone at the top of that aisle or that aisle, and we'll do our best to answer any of those questions. And again, if you do that, please use your name, where you're from, your team affiliation, and be as brief and respectful as you can be for the process. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Kate Muller from Team 2342 out of Nashua, New Hampshire. I kind of like the idea of two championships because it does allow more teams to experience this. My question is, as you're moving to more district models, how can you bring some of the, say, conference and teams meeting other teams to more of a regional event, because there are a lot of younger teams and newer teams that don't have the resources and have no idea what they can learn here, and it'll be a while before they can get here. So as the committee, as you're looking and expanding to the two events, are you looking to expand the more regional events to include some of this stuff so more teams can learn more information sooner for less money?
I've talked a lot. So.
Yeah. I think that's a great question, because when we talk about what we consider to be the championship experience, I think I don't know if you saw the survey that we sent out kind of as a follow-up to the announcement, but we listed something like, we came up with something like 22 elements that really made up the championship experience from what we could see. I think would love to be able to expand that championship experience so that when you get to it, like a district championship, it is more inclusive of those other elements. That is something that we have to work with the district folks on, because the districts are somewhat independent in terms of how they run, and it is something that should be a focus of discussions with them. I agree on that. So right now I don't have an answer, I'm sorry, but it is something we need to, I absolutely agree, we need to work on that.
So just a follow-up.
Sure.
I live very close to headquarters. How can I start volunteering to help on that subject?
Do you want to send me an email?
That'll work.
Okay.
Okay, we'll bounce back and forth so everybody gets a chance. Yes, sir.
Actually, Mike, oh, sorry. Could they turn the light? So I'm not trying to obscure us, but we can't see you. So if they could.
That's why I have to go like
just
this.
Hit the lights a little bit. Perfect.
wow, there's a lot of people here.
No, it's nice to be able to actually see who you're talking to.
So my name is Mike Corsetto, lead technical mentor for Team 1678 out of Davis, California. My first question was actually asking for an answer to the second half of question number two, which is, and why wasn't the first community asked for input on this decision? Because the more people I talked to in even chief volunteer roles, the more people I realized had no idea this was happening until the announcement. So I'd first like an answer to that question.
So I think, you know, again, it's not one of those things where we can go out and pull 400,000 people. We're, as part of doing this, we're negotiating pretty significant contracts with the convention centers and trying to understand what's available and what can we do. So I think it's part of one of those things where we're not necessarily can involve everybody in the decision process right from day one. What we're looking at is sort of, but how do we get your input to make what has to happen be a more successful type of event?
Okay. So you mentioned 80%, 20%, you want to bring FRC to more schools. My question is, when I look across the country and across the world, there's really only one model that is increasing FRC at a sustainable rate and growing teams year after year. Michigan, the last 2 years, has grown more teams than the rest of the U.S. combined. And when I look at programs at work, their program works better than the rest of the country. They work off a model where only the top teams qualify for their district championship and then move off of there. So I'm wondering what's first basis for growing the program with the model that doesn't follow Michigan's model for qualification and how they expect that to grow like Michigan's model for qualification works. Because the numbers back up their model further than the numbers for first regional model backs up the program growing. So I'm very curious to hear how you expect the program to go better with a model that isn't working as well as a model that clearly does work, which is qualifying based off of merit, not off of a wait list or off of a rookie all-star award.
So I think that, so. So we're not trying to devalue the competitive part of that, right? So the model in Michigan works for several reasons, not necessarily just for the merit-based part of that. They also have a lot of state funding that helps with growing the teams, and then they also have a network of people that actually get involved with recruiting the schools and saying and taking the reasons away why they can't do certain things. So we look at the model in Michigan sort of as the machine that can grow FRC in the way they do that. And yes, they have that competitive aspect to that, but we're also trying to make sure we honor the core value part of what we are all about, what we think FIRST is all about, and not to lose that in just a merit-based kind of structure.
My comment was regarding team growth, so I'd like team growth address.
Let me apologize for butting in, but I want to be sure we got a line of people at both mics, trying to give everybody a chance to ask a question and a follow-up. You've done both. So with your permission, I'd like to move on.
Actually, but I really do want to address as I don't think Michigan is growing FRC teams because of the way they qualify for the state championship. Michigan is growing FRC teams for three reasons. One, they've adopted and embraced the district model, which is driven locally. The district model is people in each region taking responsibility for the program there. Not just nice to have responsibility, but also financial responsibility for the programs. Secondly, it's having a growth mentality about it and saying, their leadership in Michigan says, how do we get this in every school? How do we sell this to every school administrator? And that is very helpful. And then number three, they have the incredible support of their governor and legislator who have put $3 million over the last 2 years behind funding new teams and funding teams to progress to the state championship and to the first championship. So what I would say is those are the three fundamental reasons for why FIRST Robotics grows in Michigan. That can happen everywhere with the right leadership, both within the FIRST community, but also within the governor and the legislature and the funding bodies within the departments of education within those states. That can be everywhere. That has absolutely nothing to do with how or why teams progress to the state championship. And we've actually embraced their model for the state championship for how teams progress in all of the district championships. So I think while you're saying there's this correlation, I don't think there's causality there. Because we've spent a fair amount of time with that organization to really understand what makes it work.
Okay, I'm going to jump in because thank you, Mike. Let's go to this gentleman over here on the left.
Joel Heitman, 2601, lucky to be here, first time. You stated that you were looking to split the championship in cities that were that looked good for first as far as location-wise. What was the optimal choices for that since you ended up in Houston and Detroit based on their locations? Why not have postponed kept St. Louis a little longer and looked closer towards the West Coast and maybe split them east and west a little bit more?
So again, our ideal probably would have been, I don't know, let me say Phoenix and
Salt Lake, actually.
Salt Lake, right? He knows the answer. Salt Lake and Detroit, because they're sort of East Coast, West Coast, sort of north and south. There was absolutely nothing available over there. So what we looked for was, I mean, what cities could accommodate our events? What cities could do a great job of accommodating our events? I mean, we could go to Topeka too, but you know, our team's going to have a great experience there. I don't know, maybe they would. Nothing against Topeka.
Who's here from Topeka?
But seriously, looking at sort of how do you get them, if you drive driving circles around them, how do you get it such that they overlap as little as possible and yet overlap with as many teams as possible in cities that are available and will deliver a great experience? And I can honestly tell you that both Detroit and Houston are incredibly ecstatic about showing you and everybody else that's going to be there what amazing cities they are, what they have to offer, and what great industries they have there, because they don't just want you to come there for the championship. They want you to actually move there and go to college there and hire into companies there.
All right, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
First, a comment.
Could we get your name and name?
Oh, sure. Sandra Brino, from, Team 195.
From?
Southington, Connecticut.
Great. Thank you, Sandra.
I've been a mentor for 9 years, and what I have found about FIRST to be really cool is that you took their passion for science and technology and you turned it into a sport. And that's really important at the high school age. The everyone participates kind of mentality is, it may be okay for the middle schoolers or the elementary age, but at this age, they want to be like the football team, the baseball team, and the basketball team, and they need a champion. FIRST is a family. And when we come to championship, we get to see teams that every year we get to see those same teams. And essentially, what this decision is doing is you're divorcing our family. You are separating us into two completely different areas, and we will never be able to see our siblings again. So each team is a sibling. And we want to see our big brother. We want to see 254. And we do need a champion. We
Sandra,
want them to be the champion.
Could you work your way to a question, respectfully?
The question is really, what basis do you have for divorcing a family? Essentially, you're dividing us.
Thank
and
you.
That's not cool.
Thank you.
So I don't necessarily think we look at it as divorcing this. I guess we look at it more for trying to get more to experience this type of environment. I understand. So like Don said, it's not necessarily the ideal solution. So we're trying to balance a lot of different things, and I understand that not everybody's going to like it or agree with it. So we're just trying to do our best that we can for the majority of what we think is right within our values and our core system and our mission.
And we are, as we said, we are looking at options to allow teams to kind of switch between championships.
Okay. Lady on the left.
Hi, my name is Gwen. I'm also from Team 195 out of Southington, Connecticut. And I know you guys are talking a lot about you want to make sure that everybody can experience the championship, kind of like mojo, like it's awesome. You get all these teams from all over the world. But my question is, how are you going to be districting international teams? As far as I understand, what's closer to them and what's not. But like my team is in Connecticut, so we're going to be going to Detroit. And the teams from like Mexico and Israel, and I mean, that's part of the experience is seeing all these international teams. So how are you going to be splitting it up? Because I mean, yeah, we'll be getting Canada, but we get them down in a lot of our regionals anyway. So I'm Canadian, I can say that.
So I can offend Topeka, you can offend Canada. That's good.
There you go. So like, will you allow them to be like mixed up? Because I mean, I love like watching the Mexican and Israeli teams like cheering and dancing down the aisles is actually like one of the highlights of my week. So
sure.
I just hope that you can find a way to make sure that lot of the international teams, and you get that kind of culture at both, not just Houston.
We absolutely agree with that, and we're trying to, we haven't yet determined exactly how the international teams are going to be handled. It may be something where there's like a rotation, or because of the greater distance, most of the international teams have to travel anyway. There's less of a concern probably in terms of getting to one event or the other. So that is a concern that we're looking at.
Thanks.
Gentleman on the right.
Hi, I'm Jared Russell. I'm a 15-year first participant, first as a student and mentor on Team 341, Miss Daisy, from near Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and now on Team 254 from the Silicon Valley area. When the announcement first came out, I publicly stated how I felt about this, and that really hasn't changed. But I also want to say, I see you guys are thinking big and thinking about the future. And honestly, I would be worried if you weren't. I agree that you guys need to be thinking 10 years ahead about how this program is going to grow. But my question is, when you try to scale something, and we have a hierarchical tiered competition structure, one way to scale that is to clone it, right? You take your tree of your districts and regionals and your regional, district champs and then your world champs, and you make another one of those. Another way to scale it is to push some of the things that make the first championship awesome down to the lower levels. Mm-hmm. And there, one reason why I was so confused when this announcement was made was I thought that this was first plan. You guys had a plan that you showed a few years ago involving the term super regionals, 100 to 200 team events. It's easier to find a venue for 100 teams in California than it is to find one for 400 teams. So I guess, why did you guys depart from that model? And
So I'll address that, because I created that piece of paper that's been out there, okay? So that was when we first started looking, after Michigan had gone to the district model, how do we now transition the rest of the community into what we think is a very good model to do, like what you just said, push things down to the local level. So it was a way of just looking at the district part of that, not really putting any thought into the championship, because the organization at that point was not really looking or mature enough, I think, in the thinking to think about multiple championships or what we were going to do, because what was working at that point in 2011 was working very well for us, right? And you can see on Don's chart that it was somewhat there. So the whole thought behind that was, how do we geographically break up the U.S. so we can get districts that could ultimately have 45 to 50 of these, with each state competing district championships, kind of thing like that. So that was an attempt to look at the current structure in 2011, so how we can start transitioning. But as Don said, there's some factors that have to happen for the transition to actually take hold. And part of that is local leadership. And local leadership and the fiduciary responsibility for that is a big deal. So we haven't transitioned as quickly as we would like to have because of that one factor, plus the volunteer base, making sure we don't burn them out and cultivate them along the way. So there's some other factors that happened in that we haven't transitioned everything into the district. So right now, we're hybrid running two different types of models. I'd love to go one way or the other if we could.
To be specific on that, everybody has our support to consider implementing the district model. And I know there's a number of people in California that are interested in doing that, but we haven't found the local leadership to stand up and say, I'll own it and make this happen. And it's a scary move. It's not just a trivial this week it sounds like a good idea. It's a real commitment. And the places that have done it, I don't believe are looking back. One of the things that was interesting in the feedback we got was, we think the district model is great. We're huge supporters of it, but we can lead a horse to water. We can't make the horse drink. And ultimately, the ownership of the district model is because local organizations have stepped up and said, we'll make this happen in our state. We'd love to work with you and the regional directors, whoever we need to in California, to figure out how to make that happen for California. And the hard part is, the longer you wait, the bigger you get, the harder it is to make the decision. So,
Jerry, do you need a brief follow-up, or are you okay?
Yeah. Just to clarify, I was in MAR when when that happened. I remember being in a room and Steve was there presenting, and we were skeptical. And in hindsight, the district model is great. I really enjoyed my time in that, and I wish California would move to it. But what I was
you
more
can be
getting
part
at,
of the leadership making that happen.
I'll talk to my wife first. but what I was more focusing on was like, I think you should consider, like, one thing, the Michigan State champs had two fields this year. They had over 100 teams there. It was an awesome event. It was, they had great media coverage, you know, growing that level of the competition. And I think there's a way to make it work with regionals. You can go regional, super regional. You know, I think three tiers would work. I don't know, just something to consider. And I guess one final parting thought is, I think it's good that not all first leadership are, you know, posting on Chief Delphi and sitting in this room, but how many first alumni are on the first board?
Not enough.
Well, do you know what the number is in terms of people who are in the program as a student?
Zero.
Yeah, so I think that's a problem.
Yep. Jerry, thank you very much. Let's move on. Just a moment to say, appreciate the fact that everybody's coming up, knows what you want to ask, and you're asking it in a clear way, and we're getting a lot more people that way, so thank you for that. Yes.
Hi, I'm Meg Wenzinger. I am a mentor on Team 900 from Durham, North Carolina. So one of the things that ran through my mind when this was first announced was specifically about Detroit and safety, because I'm responsible for taking 20, 30 high schoolers to a city that is notoriously very dangerous. And we actually have another mentor on our team who lived in Detroit, and when we asked him about it, he said, oh, I got out, I was terrified. So, and being in North Carolina, we're kind of on the border, we're not sure where we're going to be districted. If we end up being districted to Detroit, it could make a serious difference where even if we do qualify, we choose not to go just because of safety. So is that something that you guys took into consideration? Are you taking steps to ensure the safety, not just of the event, but you have to use public transportation, getting to the hotels and stuff?
So, of course we think about safety. I mean, safety is our number one priority for the teams and the quality of experience. But I'm here to tell you, well, how many people believe everything they read in the paper? Stop that, Roseanne. So what I'm here to tell you is, if after you've gone to Detroit, if you still think that it's not a safe place, I can assure you that's something we thought long and hard about. I think St. Louis is a great city. If you read the press on St. Louis, it's not particularly good right now. But I don't know how many of you have made the trip down to Union Station, but you couldn't throw a baseball and not hit a police officer along the route between here and Union Station. Not that we've needed them to do anything, but we're just uber vigilant on safety, and so we would not pick Detroit if we did not think it was a great place for teams to have a great experience.
And it's a situation where we integrate with the local law enforcement anytime we go to a city to understand what the plans are, make sure they have extra people in place where we need to have extra people in place. I mean, that's the reason, one of the reasons why you're seeing the greater kind of security presence in St. Louis.
So we're going to do that for both those cities, work mm-hmm. with the local for the security plan that we put in place to make sure that everybody's safe as much as we can.
But downtown Detroit is not nearly the battle zone that you would think from reading the newspaper.
So to clarify, it's not so much right where the event is, but when we went to book hotel rooms this year, we ended up 20 miles away, right? So when you end up having to have, because you have 400 teams, teams so spread out, there's a very large area that you could end up in.
So one of the things we learned this year with what I'll say is an Uber-sized championship is in any city, you're going to run into constraints for hotels and air capacity. It's not a statement about St. Louis. This is a statement about any one city for if you keep growing and growing, you're going to eventually exceed the capacity. Again, by saying move into a model, well, maybe the future looks like multiple championships. You constrain the size of what you're doing in any one city so that people don't necessarily have to be 20 miles away. Maybe they choose to be 20 miles away because they have a bus and they want to come back and forth and it's cheaper. But that is one of the benefits of sort of saying, well, let's cap the size. And rather than growing linearly in one city, how do we actually look at doing this in multiple cities?
Okay, great. We got about 10 minutes left in the official meeting. Mike, is that you back for round two?
Yes, it is.
How do the two people behind you feel about you getting round two before they get round one?
Corey's great with it.
They're great with it? All right, then so be it. Round two it is.
Great. So as a follow-up to one of my questions, I had a question regarding the community input into this decision-making process. And like you said, when you were talking about the district transition, it does take people to step up on a regional level and put together a lot of work to make this happen. I have spent hours on the phone with Jim Zondag and Gail from Michigan to attempt to make districts come to California. I've met with a lot of the key teams and the key volunteers in California to get their feedback on it and ask them, what do we need to do to make this plan work? I've written up a 20-page document proposing districts for California, all with the mindset of, I want to grow this program, all right? And I trust people like Jim Zondag to run programs like this well and to grow their programs and to make FRC something that thrives
question,
in every
Mike.
High school.
Got a question.
The question is,
thank you.
How do you expect leaders in these districts to come forward and put hours of their volunteer time into a community when they're not consulted on decisions like this that take the core of this competition program out and put it into everyone's a winner instead of pushing for greatness? How do you expect volunteers to step up when you cut the legs out from them without consulting them first?
So, Mike, I guess I respectfully disagree that we're taking the core out. When you look at, especially when Don showed a slide of, I don't know how many folks were around in 2008, but in 2008 we had about 25% of the teams attending championship. And was it that degraded of an experience that people didn't want to come back? I think the answer is, from what we've seen anyway, it was not. We essentially have a situation where we max out our teams. This year we went over our max by 7 teams. Because of the full experience that we're delivering.
Any other comments over here?
And I'm not sure how this undercuts sort of an interest in going to the district model at the California level. I mean, I understand you don't like this decision, but I don't know how that necessarily, other than you feel like you're not making the decisions, in which case, yeah, I understand that.
My answer to that is our team is motivated to be world champions, and that goal has been taken away. And that's my motivation for pushing my team and the region to be as strong as possible, is I want to bring California into the world championship. I want to bring in my team into the world championship. So that's my answer. That's what drives me, and that's what pushes me to volunteer so much time into this program. So there, that's my answer. I want to give you my reasoning.
And that's a good...
Thank you, Mike.
That's very helpful, Mike, and I appreciate your thoughts on this. I think one of the things we are looking at, because we've heard the community... Excuse me? So we're... And so one of the things that we are talking about is we put up an options on the screen is we are looking at how can we have some type of kind of culminating event over during the summer or something along those lines where we're able to bring kind of the winners from the championships together. And that's we understand that's a concern. It is something we're working on.
Gentleman on the left.
So as we're going through, and again, I'm going to reemphasize the fact that you're refusing to the community.
Your name, please. I'm sorry. Forgot to ask.
Sean, 25. Been in since 1997.
Thank you.
And you're refusing to come in and talk to the community. You don't go around and find out where the experts are. You don't go around and ask people what's going on. I could tell you right now, Detroit is a shrinking city for airlines. Houston is a shrinking city for airlines. I'm a union rep for flight attendants at United Airlines. I negotiated a $2 billion contract with them. I could tell you that those are shrinking. They're growing international and shrinking everywhere else. You're not reducing costs for teams, except for the few that can drive to it. I do have huge problems that this is one of those things where you're coming and begging for forgiveness versus asking the community that's been busting their butts because we're putting millions of man hours in.
And Sean, do you have a question?
Sure. How many of you guys have actually vacationed in Detroit? Because that's what you're asking us to do. Because this is what happens. Our kids, they're all busting their butts to go somewhere and fight. Everybody talks about Epcot. That was the reward for winning Rookie of the Year, or qualifying and winning, or going somewhere. Now the reward is, let's go to the most dangerous city in America.
Sean, I think we've got the gist of it. Thank you very much.
How many of you guys vacationed on Detroit?
I've never vacationed in Detroit. Sean, thank you. I'll ask again that everybody remember first value of gracious professionalism. Thank you. There are ways to ask a question, and we're trying to work towards those ways. Thank you. Anyone want to take that one?
I've been to Michigan like 6 times this year, and I've been to downtown Detroit multiple times. And again, I'm absolutely no more scared there than I've been anywhere else. But it's a matter of opinion.
Okay, next question. Gentleman on the right.
My name's Corey. I'm from Team 254. I've been involved in FIRST as a student and a mentor for 15 years. My question is that you're talking a lot about what sounds like potentially exponential expansion of the program. I'm wondering if you view FRC as being possible to be in every school in the country or, you know, North America or whatever your goal is. And if that's true, how do you plan to support that given your admitted lack of insight into how FRC teams run, since you just said you have no experience on your board?
So honestly, I would say a couple things. One is no organization, again, sort of talking outside of both the one organization in this world that thinks FRC can be in every school is actually First in Michigan. And if you talk to them, that is absolutely their passion. Now, do I think, I don't personally believe it's the right answer for every school. I believe that there's maybe schools where First Tech Challenge is a great way to start it, and maybe that inspires them to go into a first robotics competition. But our goal would be to sort of enable that for every school that wants to do it and to access that. And so we do our planning for how does this continue to grow? How does this continue to scale? I mean, we spend an enormous amount of time in Washington trying to get money driven down to the schools so that they can participate and not let money be the barrier to access. So again, I don't think this necessarily has to do with who's on the board. I think it's about trying to, how do we enable this and take the barriers out of the way?
So I guess my follow-up to that is, given the admission that you potentially do not have as much insight as you'd like into how teams operate, and obviously you don't have an answer to this today, but do you plan to find a way to involve us more in what happens so that you can understand what it's like to be on a team, what the challenges are in running a team, both monetarily, finding mentors to support the teams, and how your decisions affect the team experience?
So I take a little bit of offense at the idea that we have no clue what teams are doing or what it takes. I personally went to 18 First Robotics events this season, 3 a weekend for 6 weekends in a row. Actually, there was 2 weekends I went to 2. I personally made the effort to walk through the pits and talk to as many of those teams as I can. So I don't think this is a bold statement to say I've probably talked to more First Robotics teams than anybody else in this room this season. Now, did I have the time to spend with them, and did I spend every day with, you know, 50 hours a week with them? No, but I've certainly made every effort possible to get out there and understand, and not just talk to the team members, but to the mentors and understand what the challenges are. And a lot of the challenges I hear are not with FIRST, but with trying to get the school district to give them space, to give them time, to give them, to give the teachers a stipend. And so we're personally very committed to trying to, how do we help these teams overcome those barriers?
Okay, we're just about out of time. I think there's time to squeeze in one more question. So, sir, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Eric Drost. I'm a mentor for 11 and now 1923. I think we can all agree that mentors...
Good cat.
I think we can all agree that mentors are the bread and butter of this organization, yep. Yet I've heard more mentors this year than any other year talking about leaving FIRST, both in general and for other programs. How do you plan to address this moving forward?
Thank you.
Do I enter?
I think it's a, anytime you go through a major change in the program like we're seeing here, I think it's gonna generate a lot of concerns and individuals questioning whether this is the right program for them. I think personally the best thing we can do is, because some of these decisions are locked in. We are going to 2 championships. We're gonna have all 4 programs at both championships themselves. And one of the things that we're trying to do through, for example, the surveys that we sent out, and I know it was after the fact that we announced a change, and that was a concern for many, is trying to get a greater understanding from the community in terms of what makes the championship experience and what makes it special, and hopefully, as we said on one of the slides, kind of understand that and enhance. Now, I don't have an answer anyways, how when we go through any kind of major change, how can we prevent people from leaving? I wish I had an answer to that. I don't. I think the best thing we can do is try to understand what makes the FIRST experience special and try to enhance those elements and hopefully communicate them so that we can get people that are interested in supporting the program to stay.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Everybody, we used up our time. Hopefully we got as many questions in as we could. Those of you still online, if you want, I think we can stay a few more minutes. If you have any burning question you want to follow up with, come up forward. Thanks, everybody, for coming. Thank you for being so respectful. And hopefully you got some questions answered.